Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen.
Ding, ding, ding.
We know you're eating lunch, and we're so glad to be here with you. We are Dave and Joan Maroney. I'm Dave, and she's Joan. I've got a gal named Joni Maroney. I should write a song, I know. We want to make sure you can hear our voices with two of us here speaking at the microphone. So if you can't hear us, just give us one of these and we'll...
Can you hear me? Can you hear me all right? All right, good. Very good.
So we are an apostolate for the Marian Fathers called Mother of Mercy Messengers, the acronym M-O-M-M. At the National Shrine, they refer to us as Mom, which I never thought I'd be called Mom, but hey, it works for me.
Times are changing.
Oh, okay. And our role is to travel into the parishes and perhaps more importantly into the schools. We present, we have several different presentations that we give to the parish and also to the school children, introducing them to the message of the Divine Mercy. And I tell you what, when you see a gymnasium or a hall filled with 200 or 300 first and second and third graders, and they're praying the Chaplet of Mercy and have mercy on us and on the whole world, you just know our Father in heaven is just looking down going, okay, mercy, here it comes. So it's a beautiful thing. We're very glad to be here. We're thankful to Marie for inviting us to speak here at this conference.
We've been doing this now for just 19 years. We've been to about 850 parishes and schools, and we're going to share with you something today. We launched a program called Divine Mercy for America. Back in 2012, the Lord led us, the Holy Spirit really led us, right after doing a novena. Today we begin the novena in preparation for Pentecost. I encourage you all to take part of really, invoking the Holy Spirit, because it really works so powerfully. And we were led to many passages in the diary of how Sister Faustina was told explicitly how to pray for her country of Poland. And what we're going to kind of do is tie in the Fatima message, the Divine Mercy message, and then the powerful impact that this has. As we've been hearing the last 2 days, our actions have consequences, and that's why you healthcare providers, are taking care of people that, from accidents, from illness, and all these kinds of things. And then we also talk about the spiritual implications. And so Dave and I aren't doctors or priests, we're just lay people, but we have seen the healing, incredible healing that has taken place in so many hearts, souls, families, through the Divine Mercy message and devotion. It's humbling. But so we're just going to speak for about 30 minutes, so we're taking something that's a little more than an hour-long program and condensing it. So we're going to kind of try to connect some of the dots for you of why Jesus came, when he came, and the impact that this message can have in our own families, our lives, and indeed the whole world, and the important role that you play in living this message out and sharing it with others.
So it was 1931, and we're going to look at these revelations kind of in a timeline with what was going on in the world at that time. 1931 in Poland, it was a cold winter night, February 22nd. Jesus appeared to St. Faustina as she was getting ready to go to bed, as is depicted in this artwork by Mr. Tommy Canning out of Scotland. He has these rays of mercy coming out of his heart, and you imagine, he was a living human being and also God there in her room with her. So how striking that must have been, that vision of him. And so he asked her to have an image painted just as she saw him. And things were not really going so well for St. Faustina at that time. She really didn't have a spiritual director that understood her. And so she was having difficulty getting the image painted. It wasn't until she was moved to a smaller convent in the city of Vilnius. Vilnius, as you can see, is up in the northeast corner of Poland. And it's there that she meets the man that Jesus had showed her in a vision that would help her. now blessed Father Michael Sopochko. He was a theologian. He did parish work. He was a professor at the university, a very, very busy man. One of his duties was to hear the confessions of the sisters at the little convent, the Sisters of Our Lady of Mercy, where St. Faustina was. She immediately begins to open up in the confessional with him these spiritual manifestations that she's having. And Father Sopochko doesn't have the time to listen for hours to all of these revelations. And so he says, I want you to start keeping a diary. That's the inception of the diary. And of course, Jesus echoed that. He said, yes, my daughter, please write. These words will be meant for a great number of souls that will profit from it. And we certainly have seen that to this day. Millions of souls across the globe have been impacted by the words of St. Faustina, the love and the mercy of Jesus. Blessed Michael discerns in his priestly discernment, which is of paramount importance, that these happenings are of heaven and are of God. So he commissions, he happens to have a housemate. He's living, he has a room and a house. The head of the art department also has a room in the house. So he commissions Mr. Eugene Kaczmarowski to paint the image. In 1934, from January until June, the image is worked on, and finally in June of 1934, the image is completed.
So, we have one microphone, so we're not used to doing that, sharing the microphone. So, the image is painted. This is the image known as the Vilnius image. It's the only image really painted under Sister Faustina's direction. After the image was completed, eventually she was moved back to Krakow, okay? And after the war and all of that, this image now is in Lithuania. After World War II, the borders changed because it used to be Poland, now it's in Lithuania. So eventually another image was painted that hangs in the shrine in Krakow by Mr. Hyla. And then since then, many, many different images have been painted. But this is just the original one, and this is what we use in our presentations, and which has now become so popular. As Dave said, the image was completed in June of 1934, but very early on in the diary, when Sister Faustina was told to paint the image, Jesus told her he wanted something very specific to be done with that image. Do you want to read that? You know what it is.
Quoting from the diary, Jesus said, paint an image according to the pattern that you see with the signature, Jesus, I trust in you. I desire that there be a feast of mercy. I want this image, which you will paint with the brush, to be solemnly blessed on the first Sunday after Easter. That Sunday is to be the Feast of Mercy.
Well, the image wasn't painted and completed until June, all right, of 1934. So they didn't have the opportunity. Jesus said, I want it to be venerated in your chapel and then throughout the world, and I want this Feast of Mercy. So we move fast forward into 1935. Now, we just came off of a jubilee year. From 1933 to the first Sunday after Easter, there was another extraordinary jubilee year. The Holy Father had called for a jubilee of celebrating 1,900 years of the redemption. In 1933, Jesus died when he was 33, so 1933, this jubilee began. Always incredible things happened during these jubilees. And so think back then, during this time is when Sister Faustina is having these revelations. This is the time that Jesus says, I want an image painted. This is the time that Jesus is saying, I want it venerated. I want the Feast of Mercy to be established. So in 1935, it's Easter time, and Sister Faustina is telling Father Sopochko, well, remember what Jesus said. He wants this image to be venerated the first Sunday after Easter. Well, so Father, we need to do this. Well, Father Sopochko's still in discernment mode, right? So he's a little like hesitant if he's supposed to do this. But precisely because it's the end of the Jubilee year, the first Sunday after Easter that year, Father Sopochko gets a call from the bishop asking him to preach at the closing ceremonies. And so guess what? Now Father Sopochko's, okay, heaven called. I guess I have to preach. And so this is a picture taken at that celebration.
And I think Blessed Michael just jumped in with both feet at that point. And he has the image adorned. It's displayed up here. This is called the Dawn Gate or the Ostabrama there in Vilnius. It's still there to this day. And it's a whole weekend celebration, these closing ceremonies. My favorite part in the diary, around paragraph 419 in that whole area, the spiritual manifestations are just amazing, the things that she sees and witnesses on the spiritual level.
Just to kind of put it into perspective about the power of the Feast of Mercy, even going back to 1935, I'll just explain. She writes that whole weekend things were going on, and she says she went to the Ostrobrahma to attend the ceremony during which the image was displayed. I heard a sermon given by my confessor, Father Sopochko. This sermon about divine mercy was the first of the things that Jesus had asked for so very long ago. So she's very happy because it's finally coming to fruition, right? But listen to this. She says, when he began to speak about the great mercy of the Lord, the image came alive, and the rays pierced the hearts of the people there, but not all to the same degree. Some received more, some less. So already these rays are going out, God's mercy, even though these people weren't there for a quote Mercy Sunday celebration, it was the first Sunday after Easter, the octave of Easter, and the Lord is pouring his mercy out. She saw Jesus appear in the sky, cutting through nets, blessing everybody all that weekend. So the Feast of Mercy is an incredible time of great grace for us and for the whole world, and we want to take full advantage of this. And especially when you hear this, Sister Faustina says, so she leaves the ceremony and she says, on the way home, a great multitude of demons blocked my way. They threatened me with terrible tortures and voices could be heard. She has snatched away everything we have worked for over so many years. When I asked them, she wrote, where have you come from in such great numbers? The wicked forms answered, out of human hearts, stop tormenting us. Wow, right? So as we're hearing Dr. Thacher, we're talking about addictions, we're talking about depressions, we're talking about all these illnesses that we have. But through these graces, you know, and through this message, these demons are fleeing, and many of us have had them flee from our lives precisely because of God's mercy. So this was happening in 1935, and where are we after that? All right.
And it's important, you know, as Sister mentioned about Fatima, nothing new comes to the church through private revelation, which also the writings of St. Faustina come under. So as Father Seraphim has pointed out, it turns out in the church's earliest liturgical document, the Apostolic Constitutions, St. Thomas the Apostle wrote, let there be a feast on the octave of the resurrection. So this feast has already been there. It's in the church. The liturgy has always been the same. And it's all about God's mercy on that day. Jesus just wanted it more openly proclaimed. So in 1935, that's also the year that St. Faustina gets the chaplet of mercy. But what's going on in the world in 1930s in that part of the world? Hitler is rising to power in the 20s and the 30s in Germany. And we know also to the east of Poland. We know what's happened in Russia. And, you know, everybody's aware of what's going on. So St. Faustina, of course, is also. And she writes about it in her diary.
Yeah, she wrote, and again, going, I've offered this day for Russia, as we heard with the Fatima message, right? I have offered all my sufferings and prayers for that poor country. But the surprising thing is how the Lord responded.
I cannot suffer that country any longer. Do not tie my hands, my daughter.
And she continued, I understood that if it had not been for the prayers of souls that are pleasing to God, that whole nation would have already been reduced to nothingness. Oh, how I suffer for that nation which has banished God from its borders. And we have very short time, but we all know this must make us kind of wonder. You know, if God was so angry with Russia back then, how is he feeling about our world today? But the other side of it is what she said. If it hadn't been for the prayers of souls that are pleasing to God, that whole nation, our holiness is paramount importance. You know, Many people have turned their back away from God. Not as many people are coming to church. Now, your holiness, your prayerfulness is, you know, this is what is so important, all right? Okay, so Sister Faustina is not only praying for Russia, of course, she's praying for her own country. And of course, because she dies in 1938. And 1 year later, I mean, yes, exactly 1 year later, World War II breaks out. And so she's praying for her country. And you would think, well, yeah, she's got to pray for her country because they're on the verge of World War II. And luckily she did, because out of the rubble, Carol Wojtyla survives. The diary survives. Many of the convents were burned. You know, everything could have been lost. But the amazing thing is, when you really go through the diary, look, there's about 24 passages where she's told how to pray for her country, but it's always for things like this, because of its ingratitude. She sees the anger of God hanging very heavy over Poland. These passages can be summarized with passage number 1533. Less than 12 months before her death, she writes, "I saw the anger of God hanging heavy over Poland. And now I see that if God were to visit our country with the greatest chastisements, that would still be great mercy, because for such grave transgressions, he could punish us with eternal annihilation." She wrote, "I was paralyzed with fear when the Lord lifted the veil a little for me. Now I see clearly that chosen souls keep the world in existence to fulfill the measure of justice." Again, we see the two parts. God is upset. He is angry with something. But again, the importance of the chosen souls, souls that are pleasing to God. But are you wondering? That's very strong language. If he could punish us with eternal annihilation, it would still be God's mercy. What the heck? Why was he so angry? Why was he angry with Poland, this beautiful Catholic country so devoted to Our Lady? Well, we're reminded a little bit about it when we go back to the Fatima message. I forgot a part. We remember something that Father Seraphim taught us, and this had something to do when Sister Faustina received the Chaplet of Mercy. When she receives this Chaplet of Mercy, it's on September 13th of 1935. It's the 13th of the month, right? 1935. It's Friday the 13th, and she sees an angel of wrath that's about ready to strike the world. She says, "The executor of divine wrath in a clothed in a dazzling robe, his face gloriously bright, a cloud beneath his feet. From the cloud, bolts and thunder and flashes of lightning." She said, "When I saw this divine wrath which was about to strike the earth, and in particular a certain place," she was talking about the city of Warsaw actually, "she said, I began to implore the angel to hold off for a few moments and the world would do penance. But my plea was a mere nothing in the face of the divine anger." But it's at this time that Sister Faustina, she's taken into the indwelling of the Holy Trinity. And while she's there, she hears these words. And she begins to recite these words. Guess what happens to the angel? He can no longer strike. He becomes powerless. And the words that she heard were these.
"Eternal Father, I offer you the body and blood, soul and divinity of your dearly beloved Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, for our sins and those of the whole world. For the sake of his sorrowful passion, have mercy on us."
The next morning is September 14th. What feast do we celebrate on the 14th of September? The Holy Cross, the exaltation of the Holy Cross. All this makes perfect sense, because the next morning she says, "I entered the chapel and I heard these words."
"Every time you enter the chapel, immediately recite the prayer which I taught you yesterday." And that's where Jesus lays out perfectly the exact prescription of the Chaplet of Mercy that we use to this day. He said, start with the Our Father, then the Hail Mary, then the I Believe in God, and then gives us the exact words that we use today.
And he also told her, "This prayer will serve to appease my wrath." The power of this prayer, because instead of God looking down on our sinfulness, he's looking at the sacrifice of his Son. The Chaplet of Mercy is so important. There's no higher form of prayer than the Holy Mass. But by virtue of our baptism, we share in the priesthood of Christ, and now we are offering up the body, blood, soul, and divinity. This power, this prayer is extremely, extremely powerful. So we pray it as if you were immersed in the Holy Mass. It's, you know what you're saying when you say that prayer. All right, so now we have this beautiful prayer. Now, she's telling this to her spiritual director, Father Sopochko. And she's using this strong language about eternal annihilation. She's talking about the city of Warsaw being destroyed. And he writes about this in his Sumerium after she died, when he's writing about her life, and he wrote.
And this, again, is not in the diary, so I think that's why it's not widely known. And specifically, her reference to it being destroyed, like as to Sodom and Gomorrah, Blessed Michael reads this in her diary, and so he asks her, for why was that city going to be destroyed? She answered, for the sins committed there. And he said, any sin in particular? And she said, yes, the killing of the infant in the womb. She commented, the most grievous crime of all against God. So ladies and gentlemen, we're talking about the sin of abortion going on in Warsaw between World War I and World War II. Through the years, our beloved priest, Father Seraphim, had said that Warsaw was the abortion capital of Eastern Europe between World War I and World War II. And that just did not fit our concept of Poland. Poland's a Catholic country. How could this happen? So we began to dive into that and look into it more and more. And it has been confirmed. We met a Polish-born priest that's working in the U.S., and he confirmed that. He says, yes, I think it's estimated 1 million abortions took place in Warsaw at that time period. It's shocking, I know.
But we're trying to figure out, how the heck can this happen? In 2013, we went to the March for Life in Washington, D.C., and the Holy Spirit put Human Life International was just launching a DVD called On Poland and Hungary. We brought it home, and many of our questions were answered. And it goes back to Fatima. Remember what Our Lady said, as we've heard over, and if we do not pray our rosaries, if we do not pray for the conversion of Russia, it will spread its errors all over the world. HLI brings out, of course we know it's communist atheism, but one of the things they did is really an attack on family life. One of the first things they did is they put women into the workforce. And many of us have suffered. I know all the ladies are shaking their head. This puts tremendous pressure on family life, right? We don't need to go into that. But another interesting thing that they did, in 1920, Russia made available abortion for women on demand, way back in 1920. It was so rampant that they had to open up different clinics because the hospitals were being overrun. The doctors were getting nervous, saying, this is not good. And even more surprising, Joseph Stalin, the terrible dictator who was responsible for the death of millions of people, he did not like it. You know why? He said, this is going to hurt our population growth. So in the mid-1930s, the Soviet Union made abortion unavailable again. Now, I don't know if we had that map up because we're going so fast, but remember, Poland is sandwiched between Nazi Germany and communist Russia, all right? Well, this evil is seeping in. In Poland, abortion was not available for any reason. But very surprisingly, what we found out was in 1932, the penal code was changed. And what they said, they loosened it. They said, now we're going to allow abortion when the health of the mother is at risk. We talked a little bit about that yesterday. But now, for the first time in Europe, when a criminal act has occurred. Ding, ding, ding. What does that mean? Rape. Now all a woman would have to do, or anyone who dragged a woman for the abortion, was to say she was raped. And now we understood how. And Warsaw was very cosmopolitan, a very modern city. And so this is where the abortions were taking place, in Warsaw. And like Dave said, between 1932, when that penal code was loosened, and 1939, when the war broke out, about 1 million babies were aborted in Warsaw. And Sister Faustina's vision, prophecy did come true, because at the end of the war, what did happen to Warsaw? 85% of it was completely destroyed, 90% of its monuments. And we got to stop and think about, you know, what would Boston look like? What would San Antonio? What would Detroit? But you know, there's really hope here, ladies and gentlemen, because this is a message of mercy. And so we're going to share that with you, too.
So we began to look into the figures of abortion in Poland and to follow that along in the years. Joni?
So what happened is, of course, after the war, communism takes over Eastern Europe. Again, Human Life International brings this out. And they say that what happened under the Soviet health care plan, guess what they make available for women again? 1958, abortion. We did not legalize it in our country till 1973. But behind the Iron Curtain, these things were happening. So I Googled to see, well, how rampant was it? And I was surprised to see that it went from a couple hundred to a couple thousand. You got into the 1960s, it goes up to about 200,000. And every year, it's 200, 250, 280, 234,000. Every year in the 1960s and 1970s, on average, there's a quarter of a million abortions, 250,000 abortions taking place in Poland. But as I'm going down the list and I'm seeing all these statistics, wow, you get to 1981 and guess what happens? It drops to about 125,000. Significant drop. And it continues to hover over 100,000 through the 1980s. So again, we're thinking, what happened? What changed life so much in Poland that abortion is cut in half?
Our beloved Pope John Paul II is elected, and things start to change. And John Paul wants to travel. First place he goes to is Mexico City, and to see Our Lady of Guadalupe, the patroness of the unborn. And he, of course, he wants to go back to his home country. But the communists at this point, you know, they're trying to keep a lid on things in Poland. You know, they understand they've got a very volatile situation. There's a chance that he can come in May for 3 days or in June for 9 days. And the communists say, well, we don't want him coming in May. That's around the time of a Polish martyr. You know, there'll just be a general uprising. We can't have that, so he can come in June. They didn't check their liturgical calendar, though, because he landed on the vigil of Pentecost. And we hear this story from our beloved Father Casimir.
I want to see it because I love this part. This is my favorite part because I'm mimicking Father Cas. Because Father Cas was there. Father Seraphim was there, all right? And they said on June 2nd, the Holy Father, okay, this is the importance of Pentecost. Holy Father gets down off the plane and he kisses the ground and you know what he says? Holy Spirit, renew this land. And Father's, yes, and the face of the earth. And Father Cas, I don't know if you remember this, but I will never, he's like, he was there as a student. He goes, and we went everywhere. And we were dancing, and we were singing, and we were praying, and we get on the train, and we would follow the Holy Father here, there, and everywhere. And everywhere he went, Pope John Paul II is, what is he telling everybody? And this is what we heard yesterday. And this is what's in the 365 times in the Bible. Be not afraid. Be not afraid. And the people, it was like the spirit of oppression was lifted off the people. We are living under this oppression here. So what happens? The solidarity movement is born. Half the abortions don't happen anymore. People are getting back to their Catholicity, their religious life. The solidarity movement, yes, it was a political movement, but it was fueled by what? By the faith of the people. It doesn't matter what it does to a certain extent, what political party we have, but if it's not fueled with people that have the values, our Judeo-Christian beliefs, we're living the gospel message, nothing else is gonna matter. So this is what the Poles were doing, and who becomes the first Warsaw Pact country to oust the communists in 1989? It begins with the letter P. Poland. I'm Polish. I'm so proud to be an American Pole.
I just wish my wife had a little bit more passion, don't you think?
All right.
Okay.
So that Berlin Wall. How many of us were sitting there with our mouths open when that Berlin Wall? It wasn't because it was prayer. That prayer. This is this message of Fatima. Pray the rosary. Get back to our belief. So now what happens in Poland? The Berlin Wall comes down, the war, they oust the communists. Coincidentally, in 1993, the same year that Sister Faustina is beatified by a miracle of Maureen Digan, right here from the beautiful state of Massachusetts, guess what the Poles do? They put forth a people's referendum that says, we reject abortion for any reason. It didn't come because of the politics. It didn't become a it came from the hearts of the people. And by the way, we need to be praying because there's a very important referendum that's going to be taking place in Ireland in a few weeks. So please pray for Ireland. All right. So now after the people put forth this referendum, which needs to happen here too, because even if it's legal, I mean illegal, it's still going to take place for some people, right? They're still going to seek this procedure. All right, so in 1993, we go from about 100,000 abortions, and then you continue, Google it, you can see the statistics tumble, and they tumble and tumble, so that by the year 2000, when Pope John Paul II proclaims Sister Faustina saint, and he officially proclaims that from now on, the first Sunday after Easter will be known as Divine Mercy Sunday, the Feast of Mercy, there were just 134 abortions in Poland, and Poland is now considered the most pro-life country in the world.
Applause.
And the amazing thing is, at the end of that HLI video, they didn't connect it with the Divine Mercy. They're just kind of giving the statistics and talking about communism, really. They said, two people working for HLI at the end said, if you would have told us a few years ago that our nation would have been so pro-life, we never would have believed it. So ladies and gentlemen, the challenge for us is, do you believe that if Poland did it, it can happen here in the United States? Amen. Amen. So, we have put together the Divine Mercy for America plan. We figured, what did Jesus tell her to do? You know, we pray the rosary, we grow in holiness. Visit our website, divinemercyforamerica.org. We go in the whole plan is there for you. But it's very important to remember this, and this is where we've really seen so much healing. One thing Sister Faustina wrote in 1732 passage, she said, as I was praying for Poland, I heard these words. I bear a special love for Poland, and if she will be obedient to my will, I will exalt her in might and holiness, and from her will go forth the spark that will prepare the world for my final coming. And then on June 5th, 1938, precisely 4 months before she dies, she says, today I saw the glory of God which flows from the image. Many souls are receiving graces, although they do not speak of it openly. Even though it has met up with all sorts of vicissitudes, God is receiving glory because of it. And the efforts of Satan and of evil men are shattered and come to naught. In spite of Satan's anger, the divine mercy will triumph over the whole world and will be worshiped by all souls. And as Sister Angela said, the triumph of the Immaculate Heart is the triumph of the divine mercy. And the amazing thing, we got to go back. Do you remember the year that Jesus appeared to Sister Faustina when he said, paint an image according to the pattern you see. And I want this image to be venerated around the world. And I want the Feast of Mercy to be officially established in the world. And on that feast, when you come to confession, when you receive me in Holy Communion, when you are living a life of mercy, we renew our baptismal grace, all of our sins, all of our punishment. We are completely restored to God. What year was it that Jesus appeared? 1931, 1 year before that penal code was changed in Poland, 1 year before all the devastation, 1 year before this, the rise of communism that took place and the atheistic thing and the spread of abortion becomes rampant around the world, Jesus says, hold on, he sees what's going to happen. And he knows that many of us are going to make a lot of mistakes and have a lot of problems, but how does he respond? He says, paint my image. I want everybody to know about it. I want everybody to know that my mercy is greater than their sins and the entire world. And the greater the sinner, the greater the right to my mercy. So we thank God for for this message of mercy. We thank God for his wonderful Blessed Mother, and we just implore her intercession for all of us to grow in holiness so that we become more like Saint Faustina, Jacinta, Francisco, and all the saints, and that all of us become great saints, helping ourselves get to heaven, our family members, our friends, our whole entire world. So God bless you for all of your work. Do whatever you can to spread the divine mercy message and holy and devotion. But most importantly, become that great saint. And one day we'll all be there rejoicing in heaven. Glory to God. Glory to God.